What's going on, y'all? Welcome back to another podcast catered to all you geeks out there. I am Neo Synapse from the Superpowered Review, and I'm here with Superpatriot from the Daddy's House.
What's up, everybody? How y'all doing?
You can check out his Twitter at the Daddy's House and his YouTube channel. Just search for the Daddy's House or Superpatriot. So for this podcast, we're going to discuss some of the various comic book and television shows that Marvel and DC have dropped on us from network television to Netflix. This will be an ongoing series, just like our movie reviews and podcasts. So let's start. I'm going to start with a show that I stopped watching after episode 3.
Oh, blasphemy, sir.
Supergirl. Blasphemy. Okay, so basically, I'm gonna have Superpatriot catch me up, get me up to speed here, because obviously I have no idea what's going on. Now, I will tell you that I stopped watching the show because I despise campy things. That's my
it's
opinion.
It's not of the show. Campy though, sir. It's just not, you know, moody. You know, that's
I will admit I am.
My parents are dead.
I am closer.
I once was a boy.
To the Batman.
Now I am a bat.
You know, I like the darker. I do like the darker. I will admit that. You know, and I guess it's the same reason I stopped watching Gotham, which we'll talk about sometime after that as well, because campy stuff see, I feel is campy.
Gotham is so freaking dark and so not campy.
Oh,
I don't know
wow.
How you don't love that show.
Really? Oh my gosh. It is so bad with the camp. Anyway, we'll get to that. So let's get with Supergirl. All right, so I'll explain to you what happened with me. And then you can educate me. Let's say that, okay? All
right.
So, high hopes. I had super high hopes because I wanted to see this on the screen. Today's technology, you got a Kryptonian character. I wanted to see that on TV done right, especially after seeing Flash and how well they were doing with the tech on that show. And second to that, I wanted to see another strong female, you know, I can do anything a man can do character on TV, because we don't have many of those. We need that. I haven't seen anything like that, well, apart from Sleepy Hollow, but most people don't watch that I know, since Fringe back in the day. I love that female lead. She was super strong, super smart, and still feminine. So it was a beautiful thing. So I was excited for Supergirl, and then I watched it, and I said, no, this is
really
not what it should be. That's exactly how I felt. Honestly.
Wow.
Yeah. Yeah. You know?
See, I mean, I got jazzed off Supergirl right from the beginning.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, the trailers for Supergirl had me hooked. Simply because, you know, I mean, I grew up, you know, for, you know, lack of a better term, I grew up on the Richard Donner Superman.
Right.
So, you know, grew up with the whole people, you know, belief, you know, saying, you know, so, you know, I hope this hasn't turned you offline. It's still the safest way to travel.
Right,
you know?
Right.
I grew up on the whole, you know, I mean, the ending scene, the first Donner Superman, it always gets me every time. You know, when he drops Lex off there into that prison, and the warden's like, you know, it's like, this, you know, this country is safe again, thanks to you, Superman. And, you know, he says, don't thank me, warden. We're all part of the same team. That gets me every time, dude. I don't know why. But, you know, so it's like, you know, I grew up not so much on the campy. It's not so much camp. It's, you know, it's uplifting. It's, there's still hope. There's still, you know, you should feel good about doing good.
Right.
You know, and so I mean that's why I mean I really, you know, fell in love with this show even before it started. Or, you know, her saving that plane, you know, with her, you know, adopted sister on it and everything, that just hooked me. Because I mean I call me crazy, I can like imagine myself in those shoes,
right?
You know, doing something like that, and how freaking awesome I would feel.
Mm-hmm.
You know, how good that would make me feel, being able to do something like that. You know, and save people like that. So, Yeah, and I can't do that with a lot of other characters.
Yeah, that's true.
But yeah, I've never felt that it was campy. I've always felt that it was just more uplifting. You know, just had more of an uplifting feel to it.
So tell me, what do you think about? Let's go with the first season of Flash. How did you feel about that in regards to what we're talking about?
Well, the first season of Flash, I mean, it was, I mean, I would get those, you wouldn't get those moments too when you was watching Flash?
Yeah.
Just those, you would sit there and even though you knew Wells, even after we found out Wells was a bad guy, just sitting there, and Wells talking to Barry about it, and I just hearing it, run, Barry, run. you're like, I'm running, man.
It's true.
I'm gonna run.
You're absolutely right, and that's why I brought it up. Because for me, what you're describing as the uplifting feeling from the Donner films, and that being what you got from Supergirl, that's what I got from the Flash, but without that cheesy underbelly that I get from Supergirl, Gotham, and the first. Most of the first season of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., right? The way I looked at The Flash was like, wow, if I'm not in the mood for the dark and brooding of Batman or Arrow, this is the perfect medicine, the perfect remedy. It shows that you don't need to be unhappy and feel this just a complete obligation and no joy from doing good. You can enjoy it. You can have fun. And the show can still be of a caliber where you don't feel like, man, I feel like I'm supposed to be watching this with my daughter or something like this, my young 12-year-old, in order to teach them values. You know what I mean? I wanted the show to be for adults, but remind you of when you were younger. And that's not what I get from Supergirl. I get from Supergirl that you could watch this with your young daughter and say, you can be a woman and have values and not be beholden to men and things like that. You are your own person. And I get that from Supergirl. Mm. I just wanted more. Maybe it's the times we live in. Maybe I am, affected so much by the times.
So you don't get that feeling that, that Supergirl is the... Oh, man, I don't know how you say it. You don't get the feeling that this is, there's a, relationship there with Supergirl to where, she is setting an example or learning, how to, set that example as, a strong leading female character.
Yes, I will say that. I do get that she's learning, because from what I've kept up as far as reading, I don't know, the details of episodes, but from what I've seen, she's got her friends, especially Cat Grant, who's been basically like a role model or teaching her that she can be more.
That character is so much more a mentor to her than any other character in that show. It's just, and I've sat there... I've sat here, every week, and I've watched the episode, and the conversations that she has with, Kara Danvers, Supergirl's, secret identity, the conversations they have together, I'm sitting there, I was like, oh my God, this is so freaking good.
Right.
She is mentoring, Supergirl in ways that, she has no idea.
Right.
And I think the relationship between those two characters is just phenomenal in that regard. So that's why when you said that, you keep saying cheesy. What exactly is the cheese?
Well, I think the main point of contention for me is that she makes mistakes, and some of the things she says, they're not the mistakes that you make at that age. You know what I mean? I feel like she's doing things you would see Clark Kent in Smallville, the Smallville TV. I don't know if you ever watched that series, but when he was in high school, some of the decisions he would make, some of the weighty emotional things that he was going through, how that impacted the decisions that he made. It's the same I see from her, but she's supposed to be already, what, in her 20s? Like, what, early to mid-20s?
Early 20s, yeah.
Right? And I understand, you know, early to mid-20s, you're still not, you know, completely into yourself and all of that. I do get that. But at least for me, there needs to be this difference, this I don't want to see you making mistakes a high schooler makes, you know, superpowers
or not. What what mistakes?
This was so long ago because it was the first three episodes, but I remember there was an argument with her sister about using her powers, and the argument reminded me of, like, you know, those in those movies you see those teenagers saying, "I can do whatever I want, Mom." That kind of thing. That's the impression that I got from that argument, and I didn't like that. You know,
I think I understand what you're getting at. You know, and it's one thing that the Cat Grant character is constantly making quips about you know, her and the Wynn and Jimmy Olsen, you know, anybody else their age and all that. She's constantly making millennial jokes.
Right.
At them. And I think the reason why you are annoyed by them making, you know, her making, you know, like, high schooler mistakes is because that's what millennials do.
Oh boy. I didn't say that. I was not party to that.
I'm sorry. I have a son who is about that age, you know, and he is just, you know, one of those things. I mean, it's, you know, not a slight against anybody. It's just, you know, millennials have grown up a little bit more sheltered than, you know, your 90s Smallville characters. Have, you know, and so, yeah, they're gonna make, you know, mistakes that, you know, we would have figured out not to do, you know, a while ago. But that's what they do on the show. I mean, you know, Cat Grant's constantly making millennial jokes.
Right.
On there, and it was especially funny when they did the Flash crossover, because then she was, you know, she's standing there looking at all four of them, you know, Barry Allen standing there with, you know, Kara Danvers, Jimmy Olsen, and, you know, Wynn, and she's standing there looking at them all. She's like, you guys are all look like, you know, you're standing there looking at me with these blank looks on your face. You guys look like, you know, the cast from a CW show.
Oh, wow. You know? That's hilarious.
Yeah, and they kind of call it as they see it and everything on there, and so don't get mad at me for calling it as I see
right,
it,
right,
folks. All right,
wow. That's I didn't see the crossover, obviously, but wow, that's a huge line there. That kind of puts things into perspective as far as what the showrunners are trying to do with the show. That is very interesting.
Yeah, I mean, they're trying to put her out there. I mean, because, like, I mean, she is, you know, she is in her mid-20s, but she has not been doing the superhero thing for long at all. Mm-hmm. You know, she just started doing it. And even though she's had her powers ever since she got here and she's been able to control and use those powers, you know, she's still new to it. I mean, there was a period in there where Jimmy was constantly getting hold of Superman to come bail her out.
Right.
I don't know if you saw that or not.
Yeah.
And she was like, you know, she needs to stop that. You know, she said, I need to do this on my own. You know, Clark, you know, he agreed. He's like, you know, it won't happen again, you know, unless it's really bad. Mm-hmm. I'll show up. But, you know, and she'd been doing all right. Having the whole big, you know, rise and all that, you know, very strong following, you know, people, you know, falling in love with her and all that, you know, the hero of National City and everything. Mm-hmm. I'm not, you know, like you said, you stopped at three episodes. I can't remember every single episode and how it all went down and everything. But you did, so you've completely missed the reveal of the Martian Manhunter then.
Right. I missed the details of that reveal. Like I said, I've been reading, so I know, you know, that it happened, but how it happened, yeah, completely lost on that.
Yeah, so, you know, the Hank Henshaw that's, you know, on the show and all that is actually the Martian Manhunter, which they've gone through here, because we're coming up on the season finale now.
Okay.
Where they've showed how her stepfather, you know, her adopted father, rather, found, you know, the Martian Manhunter and, you know, how he came about taking over Hank Henshaw's, you know, life, mm-hmm. basically, you know, assuming the Hank Henshaw identity, where, you know, Hank, you know, supposedly died in this jungle where they were out hunting the Martian,
right.
you know, Manhunter.
Right, kind of like Predator.
where, you know, her adopted father supposedly died. But it's been revealed now that, you know, he is alive, or he believes that he's alive. So him and her sister, they've gone off to try and find him now. Mm. There's some great episodes you got. I mean, if you don't watch any other episode between episode 3 and the most recent episodes, definitely go check out the episode 13 for the girl who has everything.
Right.
That was their homage or, you know, adaption to the Alan Moore story from one of the Superman annuals. I can't remember what number it was. But they also did an episode of that on Justice League Unlimited.
Right, I did see that. I definitely
where
saw that.
the Black Mercy and everything, you know, took him back to, you know, was put on Superman, took him back to, you know, he was like, you know, in his mind he was living on Krypton, and everything. They did an homage episode of that where her uncle Non sent the Black Mercy in, you know, attached to her and all that to, you know, take her out of the equation. There and everything, and her aunt is the one who actually ends up helping her get that off. And I know you've probably seen the Justice League episode where they had that happen.
Yes,
right?
Yes, I definitely saw it.
All right, well, really you saw what happened when they finally got the thing off of Superman in there.
Mm-hmm.
Well, not much of a difference to the ending there. Yeah, she, dude, you could see on her face. I mean, I love this episode. Once they get that plan off of her and all that, she's standing there, you know, she's like recollecting herself for a minute, and she turns and she looks at everybody, and you can just see on her face that she has very ill thoughts about what she's about ready to do.
And she just
stands there and she looks at them all. She's like, "Who did this to me?"
Oh.
You know, and you're like, she's going to kick somebody's ass. but yeah, definitely check that episode out. Check out episode 16, The Falling. That's where Supergirl, she comes in contact with Red Kryptonite.
Mm.
And Red Kryptonite is what basically makes Kryptonians on Earth, at least, a little more evil. And you get to see a side of her where, for a while there, you're like, okay, this is kind of cool. I kind of like her like this, but then she like gradually starts getting meaner,
mm-hmm. yeah.
and you're like, okay, this isn't cool. But that goes on for a couple of episodes where she kind of loses the trust of the city for a while there, and then they do the World's Finest crossover episode with the Flash, which has the origin of the Silver Banshee in there. We see the return of Livewire, and it's a really good it's a really good episode. I mean, it by far a much better crossover episode than Batman versus Superman, in my opinion. Yeah, I said it.
Well, if you've been following us here, guys, at the Superpower Review, you know that while we liked Batman v Superman, it was entertaining. We did not pull any punches in our review. And the last podcast that we did when I had my friend James over, it had its fair share, a voluminous share of problems. Yes, I do agree. I do agree.
It just didn't have to be all so dour.
Yeah.
It was dour. It's like I was sitting here and, you know, you hear me talk about the ending of the Donner 78 Superman. Mm-hmm. And I was sitting here, I was watching one of the final scenes in Man of Steel, where, he crashes that drone down in front of the general and all that, and they that conversation right there. And I was just thinking to myself, I was like, you know, we've come a long way from, you know, don't thank me, we're all part of the same team, to, you know, telling somebody that, you know, I've got to do it on my own terms and I'm just going to have to trust you.
Right.
You know, and I'm like, you know, and even with Man of Steel, I mean, even as, you know, dark and dour as that movie could be at moments, even with that ending right there, when he tells him, he's not, I'll just have to trust you. And he, you know, takes off. I mean, I was like, okay, there's a chance where okay, we can start getting a little bit more uplifting.
Right.
You know, it doesn't have to be all, the whole time, you know. Right, yeah. You know, it just, Batman vs. Superman, just, that's an entirely different conversation.
Yes, that it is.
You do not want to get me off on a tangent on right now.
We'll save that for another podcast.
But yeah, definitely check out the Supergirl, because, they did the crossover and all that with The Flash. I thought it was phenomenal. I thought it was so good, well written. Great interaction between the characters and everything. It was just so cool. You see her, she's Supergirl, mm-hmm. And she sees what Barry can do, and she's still, amazed by it.
Right.
And, you may have seen the scene where they're like, how can you travel between, universes and everything? How can you go that fast? And then he takes off and he comes back with ice cream cones for him all, and she's just like, that giddy look on her face, like, oh my god, this is so cool.
Right.
it's just really cute, but it's really good interactions on it. And then Barry gets to have his moment of mentoring her a little bit with, she's talking about how, she lost the city's trust and everything, with everything that happened. And he talks to her about his own experience with that. Mm-hmm. And, then, of course, the most recent episode that aired this week is, the leading up to the season finale here, where we're going to find out exactly what the escaped prisoner Kryptonians have been up to this whole time. So, but I don't want to ruin that too much for you. So,
yeah, I'll definitely check it out. I'm pulling up CBS.com, ready to watch this after we're done. We're done here. but speaking of the crossover, Flash is definitely one of my favorite shows, and that crossover is based in part. And what's been going on in the last few episodes of The Flash. So how have you been liking that storyline?
The Flash. I gotta admit, completely caught off guard by the whole Jay Garrick thing.
Yeah.
I was, him, I've got theories, wait. Zoom's real name is actually Hunter Zolzman, mm-hmm. So it's the Earth One, it's Hunter Zolom. I'm trying to figure out what the hell is going on.
Right. Yeah.
Because I know we know it's not the Jay Garrick that they had been talking to the whole time. Because you had Zoom carrying Jay's body into that little prison cell area.
See, that's what I thought. That's what I thought they were going to go with. But in the more recent episodes of The Flash, it seems to me like they think it is him. Like, they're using the helmet that he came with, almost as like a reminder that you can't trust people almost. And when they brought up the fact that, oh, we saw Zoom kill him, Barry said something to the effect of, well, we did see Harrison Wells in two places at once, so it's not like he couldn't have just shown us what we wanted to see, which would lead credence to the notion that it's not, that it is their Jay that they think it is. And that's confusing to me, because like you, I'm seeing Zoom carrying Jay's body in his world, in Earth too. So how could it be the same Zoom? How could it be the same Jay, I mean?
Yeah, that's what I'm saying. It's the Hunter Zolomon that he found on Earth 1. Because remember when they were talking, he took Caitlin out to that park.
Right.
Where they, you know, they found his doppelganger, but his name was actually Hunter Zolomon because he was adopted. Mm-hmm. You know, the possibility that, I mean, it's actually that doppelganger of himself that is Zoom. But at the same time, I'm like, I mean, I don't believe it's the Jay Garrick because, like, you know, like we said, you know, you see that, you know, part where, you know, he reached through, grabbed him, you know, pulled him through that breach and all that, and he carries his body in, whether he's dead or not, we don't know, mm-hmm. you know, into that little prison and all that, and drops him down there on the floor. So, yeah, I don't think it's Jay. I think the reason why, but yet they haven't pieced it together yet.
Okay,
is what I think, that, you know, it's the Hunter Zolomon from Earth One who is Zoom, and somehow he's able to travel back and forth between. The thing that I found most interesting was the reason why he's trying to take Barry's speed is because, you know, he's dying.
Yeah.
When, you know, the whole reveal with, what was her name, Velocity?
Mm-hmm. No, it was, what was her name?
Oh, man.
The drug they were taking was Velocity 9.
Yeah.
Her name, wow. Yeah, so she's a speedster, whatever.
Yeah, that's speedster girl. Yeah, her. we totally know exactly what we're talking right. about here, folks. Well, you guys, everybody out there listening, I ain't doubts. We totally know what we're talking about. We just may forget a name or two along the way, all right? But, yeah, so, yeah, when he realized he saw her, you know, her lightning was blue, you know, and then she just gone, you know, that's when they realized that she was dying and all that, and that's why they think that, you know, Jay is part, you know, is actually Zoom and
right.
all this other stuff.
Trajectory is the name of it.
Yeah, it's, I think it's just a series of coincidences in that regards right there. But to, I don't know, I really want to see these next few episodes. because they've been dangling this over us for like so damn long. I mean, for the longest time, you know, where everybody was, you know, talking about who is Zoom, and I thought it was going to be Eddie.
Right. Thong. That would have been cool.
I thought it was Eddie Thong for the longest time, which would have been like made a lot of sense to me and everything, but it's not. Now I think Eddie's the guy that's in the freaking mask thing that's in Zoom's little prison area. I'm really enjoying Flash.
Yeah.
I mean, you can't not enjoy Flash. I mean, if you're not enjoying Flash, then, you know, what's wrong with you?
I agree with that. Definitely.
What's wrong with you?
It's a wonderful show, man. It's definitely up there. It's if I don't feel like watching any TV for that week, that's the show that'll get me to watch something, you know. It's a fantastic show. They do a great job of balancing the darker elements of, you know, having to fight crime, having this obligation because you can do that you should do, mm-hmm. with the whole enjoying that you are able to do, enjoying the fact that you can save lives, that you can help people. And I really do enjoy the show, even if just for that, you know, really cool stuff.
And it's the thing is too, I mean, it's, you know, like Supergirl, I mean, it gets you in the feels at times.
Yeah.
You know, it really gets you in the feels at times. You know, I mean, I haven't, you know, broken down and, you know, bawled, you know, yet. If you go check out, you know, Kevin Smith is, you know, check out, he's got a YouTube video up on his channel of him just breaking down bawling at the scene where, you know, Barry's there when his mother's dying.
Oh, man, that almost got me. It almost got me. I'm not going to lie.
Oh, but, man. You see this, you know, he's just sitting there, he's like, like, you know, but the thing is, I can't laugh at the guy because, I mean, that scene didn't get me in that way, but I've had other scenes from shows and movies and all that, that have, like, you know, like, punched me right in the freaking chest, and let them cry! Yeah. <You know? laughs>
It's real.
And I've sat here and I've blubbered up all over the place. It definitely gets you in the feels.
One of the greatest shows, man. Definitely. All right. Well, we didn't get a new Flash or a new Arrow this week, as we were saying.
No, we did not.
Hopefully they'll come back next week. I'm not sure the date for that yet, but hopefully.
Well, let me ask you a question about Arrow.
Mm-hmm.
Do you really think Laurel's dead?
I want her to be. I think these shows especially need serious consequences. You know, because comic books, they definitely tend to it's almost like Dragon Ball Z, if anybody out there watches that. You know, when people die, you don't care. Because they're coming back, you know. Whether it takes an episode or 10 episodes, they are coming back. And comic books pretty much do the same thing.
I mean, it's like the running joke is in comic books, the only people who stay dead are the Waynes and Uncle Ben.
That's pretty good. I haven't heard that. That's pretty good.
But and for the longest time, Bucky was included in there, but they brought him back.
They brought him back. So. They had to. You know why? I don't know. They have this thing with death, I guess. For as dark as they can get, they don't want to let anybody stay dead. I don't know why. But so I do want her to stay dead. And honestly, I will be honest, not just because of that reason, but I didn't like the character. You know, the decision she made with the knowledge that she had, the decision she made to take her sister to Lian Yu to resurrect her.
Every character in that show makes really stupid decisions.
Yes.
You talk about Supergirl making decisions where she should know better. These people actually do know better.
And then they do this. Yes. And this is one of the reasons. It's only the only reason I watch that still is because it's a darker show and that's more my fancy. But it's up there with Gotham and Supergirl as far as that kind of thing where people make decisions that are like, you're a grown man. Come on. What are you doing? So yeah, for her, that when she did that solidified it with me for that character that she just doesn't care. I mean, yeah, she is an addict because obviously that's not something that goes away. So those vulnerabilities, I'll say, kind of make it easier for her to make those decisions. But I'm tired, guy. I am so tired of seeing it over and over with Oliver and the lying, you know, with...
I know.
I'm tired. I'm like, come on.
I'm going to say this. You know, Oliver keeping secrets from them and all that, depending on what it is, I mean, if it's something that went on that island and all that, I mean, he's obviously got, you know, tons of secrets left, you know, from what happened to him on the island and everything. But as far as I'm concerned, Felicity getting all pissy about him not telling her about his son.
Yeah.
You know, so freaking irrational.
Yeah, I agree with that. 100% I agree.
So irrational.
Yeah.
I'm like, come on, seriously. The woman told him he couldn't tell anybody if he wanted to know his kid.
Yeah. Yeah.
Please.
Now, listen, what I wanted from that was him to, you know, be like, oh, I can't do this anymore. I have to tell you because you're the love of my life, whatever. And then she would understand. That's what I wanted from that to happen, you know?
Yeah.
But, I mean, it's the guy's kid. If you want to be in the kid's, it's not like he knew from God knows how long. This thing was sprung on him. So the mere fact that he has a child is huge in and of itself. But he was given this ultimatum. I cannot see my kid if I tell anybody about this. I cannot see. And this is coming from me, who Felicity is actually my favorite character on the show, in the same way that Cisco is my favorite character on Flash. But I didn't understand. And the way she's acted in the past, knowing him and what he does and how he does things, I feel like even more so, even if, like, let's say this was a real life situation between two real people, I would feel the same that she or he or whatever the situation is would understand. But in this situation, knowing his past and everything, I feel like she should have been way, way more understanding.
Yeah.
Did not like that at all.
Yeah. Not at all. I wasn't a fan of that either. Yeah, we're sitting here, we're like harping on all these things and all that. We both love the show,
though. Yes. That's why we
don't
know everything.
Don't get us wrong, folks. Don't get us wrong, folks. I don't think she's dead. I really don't think she's dead. I mean, there's a lot of people that are, I mean, you are kind of like hoping she is because you don't, you know, like what they've been doing with the character. But there's a lot of people that have liked some of the things that they've been doing with the character, especially recently. And they're like up in arms that she is, you know, has died, as far as we know. Personally, I don't think she's dead, though. The actress she's supposed to be making an appearance on Flash. On the Flash as the Earth 2 version of herself.
Which means she may have meta powers then, right?
I believe so, yeah.
That would be cool. That actual would be, Sonic Cry.
Yeah, that would be kind of cool. I don't think she's gone. I really don't think she's gone. I think we're going to see her come back before the season finale, if not after or on the season finale. Personally,
but apart from Leanne, you, how do you think? We're obviously, you're not talking about flashbacks. You're talking about her physically being alive again.
I think they faked her death right there. I think because there are drugs that can slow your heart rate down. They can mask your breathing and everything that make it look like you are dead. And I think. Oliver gave, when she asked him, to do a favor for her or keep a secret for her, so whatever it was that they're there to, end, they had that conversation. I think she, had a plan or had a reason for him to fake her death.
That is actually a really good point. Because there is a point you don't see them. Like, she asks that, and then they cut to outside of the room. So you have no idea what she asked.
Right. Not to mention the fact, they said that she's going to be perfectly fine. She's going to make a full recovery.
Then all of a sudden, some kind of clot or embolism or something. That's a very good point. That could very well happen. But that also goes back to now, this is another secret Oliver is keeping from his team.
Oh, I know. I know. Especially during an episode where he was like saying, he's like, I've got to stop keeping secrets from you guys. You guys deserve to know everything. Blah, 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 blah. And then all of a sudden Laurel's like, you fake my death and not tell anybody?
Oh, man. I really wish they would just go a different direction. When they did the whole, Oliver and her, they're happy wherever they do. I hoped to God that when he came back and he's been the Green Arrow now, that things are going to be different, at least in that aspect, man. None of the lying
yeah.
I'm just tired, man. This is why, again, The Flash, and for you, Supergirl, is just so huge when it comes to this stuff because... Man, there are so many Batman copies. You know what I mean?
Oh, yeah.
Oh, my gosh. But, yeah, we do enjoy it.
Exactly what you're talking about, Overwatch.
Right. Right. Overwatch the Oracle. Yeah, absolutely right. Absolutely right.
Oh man, I'm gonna become, when I become a superhero, I'm gonna get somebody in a wheelchair to do my computer stuff for me, and I'm gonna call them fortune teller.
I'll do one. I'll call mine Miss Cleo, like we talked about. The day.
Oh my god! Person who can see in the future.
Yes, basically.
That's going to be their code name right there.
Terrible, man.
Oh, man.
So, yeah, so we got those season finales coming up as well. We're going to get to see the, or maybe not the end, who knows, but at least a conclusion to this current arc of the Damian Dark storyline, which has been pretty cool. I can't say that I'm upset at how they're doing things, except for, do you kind of get the impression it's kind of a rehash of the whole take over the city and blow up?
Well, I mean, thing, you know? I guess once, you know, somebody tries to do it, somebody else is going to come along and try and do it too. Yeah,
I guess.
Yeah. I'm really hoping to see more of Constantine, to be honest with you. I would love to see Constantine come back again.
Don't even get me started. Oh my god!
For you know, the season finale for Arrow, I think that would be freaking awesome.
Oh, what if? Oh, is that what you're thinking as far as her coming back? That he has something to do with it?
No. I think they just totally. He gave her a drug that made it look like she died, and she's perfectly fine. You know, somewhere hidden out somewhere. I don't think she died at all. I think she just, you know, like it was all fake.
Man. But yeah, definitely, Constantine was one of my favorite, absolute favorite shows when it was on. I guess it didn't do too well in the ratings department or well enough to justify the money that was needed to produce the show.
Well, it was on NBC for one, and obviously it wasn't part of their, not that, you know, all these shows are part of the same universe, but they're all part of the same production company, and I don't think Constantine was. And I think part of it had some to do with the writing. Not to mention the fact that, Constantine's kind of an obscure name for you to start trying to have for him to be headlining a show.
Right.
As good as the show was, and I enjoyed watching it, it's just, he's too obscure of a name, even though they've got a movie with Keanu Reeves in it.
True indeed. True indeed. Maybe they could find a place on Netflix, or, you know, wishful thinking, I know, but that seems like the best venue
that for seems that. Like, that seems like everybody's last ditch hope for every show that's been canceled.
Oh, man.
Young Justice Season 3, Netflix.
Hey, that almost happened.
Oh, that's not happening now?
Nope.
Damn!
Well, not officially. I will say there has been no new information since that guy was like, oh, keep watching it. Yeah. I mean, I hope it happens still, because that was a phenomenal show. I think that show for this generation is like Justice League was.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
And JLU. I mean, just phenomenal stuff.
I can't believe they stopped doing that for the second season. Especially with the way they ended that second season.
Mm-hmm.
Business as usual. Are you shitting me?
I'd like to see that business, please. But yeah, so, all right, cool.
Yeah.
So we've got Flash, we've got Supergirl, we've got Arrow. So I guess next up we can talk about Gotham. Gotham is another show that I stopped watching for the reasons you heard me talk about earlier, as far as, you know, being campy. And campy doesn't necessarily negate the darkness of a show. I think it's more to do with how situations are handled in a show versus how they would be handled in a more serious and or even one-to-one real-life kind of scenario. And that's how I felt about Gotham. It was really,
I'm still having a hard time wrapping my head around the campy part of Gotham.
Okay, let me give you a perfect example. Do you remember Tim Burton's Batman?
Yeah.
Okay, that is a perfect example for me of a show that is dark, but also campy.
Okay.
You know, Batman. What's the name? Batman and Robin, the absolute worst movie to have ever been produced.
You sure have not seen? All right. First of all, while I'm not disagreeing with you, all right, I'm not necessarily disagreeing with you. You have not seen Troll 2. All right.
I have never even heard of that. You're saying that,
you have not seen Troll 2.
No, I have not. And I don't think I want to if you're saying it's worse than Batman and Robin.
Oh God.
Oh God. Okay. But yeah, that show was lighter in tone, but obviously super campy with some of the puns and things like that. Or I could give you an example of camp that works. The Sam Raimi Spider-Man movies, Spider-Man 1 and 2 and like 5 minutes of Spider-Man 3, where you can get the camp, you know, some of the lines Green Goblin had and some of his, you know, dramatic presence that was there that wasn't really, you're not going to see that in the Nolan Batman universe, and you're not going to see that in, you're not even going to see that in The Flash, which is even a lighter show, you know what I mean? But it's certain ways that you handle situations, certain writing decisions that you make that make the camp real for me. It's just a cheesiness that sometimes works depending on what you're trying to do, but a lot of times it doesn't work because I don't like it. I don't like camp in general. And that's what I get from Gotham, you know?
But yeah. You had to point out a specific instance. Because I'm sorry, we're talking about a TV series that has a penguin who...
He's not a literal penguin.
But, you know, but he has a penguin who, you know, not only had a, his right-hand man brainwashed or, you know, operated on or whatever to have to obey everything he says, but also cut off the dude's hand.
Yes, he did. Which speaks of the darkness, but not to whether or not it's campy.
Now, don't get me wrong, the penguin in it is definitely an oddball, but, I mean, he's by far probably one of the best characters in the show.
Absolutely agree. Absolutely. Him and Nygma are probably my favorite characters.
Unless your definition of campy is completely different than mine. I don't see it.
Maybe that could be what it is. Let's let me see here. Okay, so we got some synonyms for campy: tasteless. Mm-hmm. We got actual definition: providing sophisticated amusement by virtue of having artificially and vulgarly mannered or banal or sentimental qualities. That's how they're using campy.
Okay.
Let's try this other one. So they generally use it when you're talking about things that are corny.
I haven't really seen anything corny in it, though.
In Gotham? Really?
Yeah.
Oh, man. You know what? I will have to, for our next episode, when we're talking about the next Gotham, I will have to go back and look at some things to get specific things, because it's not coming to mind right now, because I've basically given up on the show. Apart from, you know,
especially these last few episodes, I mean, it's really taken a turn for the better in my opinion. Where, you know, they had, you know, Gordon was framed by, you know, Edward Nygma, who is becoming, oh my God, so good.
Yeah. I would agree with that. Catching up to do this podcast, mm-hmm. I will say the last few episodes I was actually pretty impressed with, especially Nygma. I was seeing tidbits here and there of his transformation earlier. I mean, the dude is just batshit crazy, and the way that they did that with the whole mirror image and him,
yeah,
you know, becoming closer and closer to who he truly is, I found it really, really good, you know. So I guess maybe that's similar to Supergirl, you know. Maybe the first 10 episodes would have been in the same wheelhouse for me, but then after that, if I had continued watching things would have, I guess, settled into themselves as far as the writing and the acting, all of that, and it would have put me in a better spot as far as how I feel about both of those shows. You know, so maybe I just need to give it more. I always thought 3 or 4 episodes was enough to determine whether I was going to like a show, and it usually is, but maybe it's not for these two shows. Who knows?
But yeah, the progress, you know, of, you know, Enigma becoming the Riddler, and of course we saw another, you know, Penguin's going good. Nope, he's bad again. Yeah. You know, turn, and everything.
I felt so bad for him.
Yeah, I mean, he's one of those characters where you're like, you know, he's so evil, but you feel bad because it's like, you know, he could have been good.
Yeah. Yeah.
If people would just stop messing with him, you know? You know, especially, I'm sorry, you find out the dude is a murderer, and you're going to mess with him.
Yeah.
The way those people did. Oh, come on, man.
Thank you. Thank you for reminding me. That whole family dynamic was campy. Was straight.
All right, I can see that. I can't see that because, you know, they did kind of reach into the Tim Burton.
Yes.
Esque era of that with him. I mean, they even recast Paul Rubens as his father.
Yeah, which is pretty fantastic.
Anybody out there that doesn't know, watch Batman Returns. You'll see Paul Rubens, a.k.a. Pee-wee Herman, playing the Penguin's father in that movie as well as in Gotham. So, all right, so now I got a question I got to ask you.
Mm-hmm.
Because I have another friend that outright detests Gotham.
Mm-hmm.
He cannot stand the show at all, and it's mainly because of one character. How do you feel about young Bruce Wayne?
I think I like what they're doing. You know, I think, what was he, 9 years old or 10 or something when his parents got shot in the show?
Right.
I think that's old enough for him to have developed certain personality traits of being wealthy and privileged and spoiled and that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
But since you don't know much about his upbringing up to that point, you can kind of see, or not see, but you can forgive how quickly he's become what he's become. Because we don't know his dynamic with his father. We don't know his level of intelligence until after all of these negative things happened. So, you know, if I was to find a negative about it, it would be that it was kind of fast, his descent into all of this. And, I mean, to be honest with you, only because it's Batman, you can forgive this, but there is no guardian in their right mind that would see what this child is doing and not put that child into therapy immediately. There is no guardian that would do that. Right, but because it's Batman, you forgive all of that. And I think I like what they're doing because the guy who plays Jim Gordon, I forget his name, he said, somebody asked him, when will we see Batman? They asked, when will the show end? And he said, the show would end when Bruce Wayne puts on the cowl for the first time, you know? So
he's got high hopes. That's like 10 years from
That's
now.
10 years from now, exactly. He's definitely got high hopes, right? But I can see how they're building Bruce for that because, you know, he wants to understand the criminal underbelly. He wants to become a physical specimen, a mental specimen in order to do what he eventually will figure out that what he feels he needs to do or whatever. And it's kind of cool to me how they're doing it. You know, it's slow. Not as slow as I would like, but I mean, it's TV. You can't really expect too much. Shows get canceled really quickly all the time. So,
yeah.
Yeah, I like him. I do. I don't like Selena.
Really? I've had people not liking her either.
Yeah, Selena to me is just
bunch of child haters out there.
No.
I
don't know, man. Certain decisions that she makes that don't make sense to me don't jive with certain decisions that she makes on the other side. You know what I mean? I feel like that when she makes a good decision, it requires a maturity level that tells me that she wouldn't make another kind of decision. But then she ends up making that kind of decision. Right. So there's this disconnect for me with her there. But it's forgivable because she's not always in the show. So I'm just like, yeah, that's fine. You know?
Yeah, so man, that one buddy of mine that, you know, hates, I mean, I've never heard somebody wish actual harm to a child before. I mean, and this is a very mild-mannered dude, too. And he is like, I wish that kid would fall down in a cave and die.
Oh, my.
You know, and I'm like, oh,
why, what's his problem with him?
He doesn't feel that the show should have Bruce Wayne in it at all. Like, you know, at the beginning, you know, with the, you know, the Wayne's death, fine. Mm-hmm. But then that's it. He should not be in there at all. It should be Jim Gordon's story.
But it's
solely
not called
Jim Gordon's story. It's not called Gordon. The show's
right.
called Gotham, not right. Gordon.
Yeah. I mean, you can't tell a story about Gotham and it begin with the death of Bruce Wayne's parents, and then you just, yeah, I think he's over in Siberia somewhere.
Yeah.
Never, you know what I mean? That can't work. Not at all. I think they're doing fine with that, to be honest with you. You know, I do like the show, mostly. It's just, and another thing I will say that kind of adds on to why I stopped watching some of these shows is that there are so many shows, and I just get overwhelmed, you know? It's Christmas, man.
Yeah. Speaking of which, while we're on that topic, Legends of Tomorrow.
Oh, my. Listen to me. From the very first episode of that show, I knew that I was not going to enjoy that show. And I still gave it my requisite 3 or 4 episodes before I stopped watching it, hoping that it would grow into itself. And I have seen every episode. I stopped watching it, but I caught up, and I've seen every episode. And it's still bad. Still bad.
I don't want to sit here and say it's bad because it's had its moments. It's had its moments. For me, though, out of all the shows, Legends of Tomorrow is probably the one I have the most doubts about, the least likes about. And because it seems to me like, you know, it seems to me like the producers of this show, they came up with a show that they could include cast favorites from other shows on.
Right.
That's purely the reason why they did it. You know, I mean, you know, you got people who are huge fans of the actors that play Captain Cold and Heatwave.
Mm-hmm.
You know, because of their run on Prison Break, which is supposed to be coming back.
Yes, it is.
From what I understand. So, you know, you got people who are fans of those actors, you know, in the way they portray Captain Cold and Heatwave. You got people who were fans of the Katie Lotz, Black Canary.
Yes,
you
that's
know, who
me.
Who they brought back for to be the White Canary on here. You got the actor that plays Professor Hamilton. I can't remember his name.
Martin Stein.
Well, yeah, that's his.
Wait.
Did I say Hamilton?
Yeah.
Where did I get Hamilton from?
Probably from Flash as a name that sounds like Harrison, maybe. I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Anyways, yeah, but the actor who plays Martin Stein, Professor Stein, you know, who's half of
Firestorm.
Firestorm and all that. You know, he's a good actor. He's been in a lot of stuff.
He's phenomenal.
You know, and then you've got Brandon Roth. You know, I'm sorry, the only actor I remember the name of. Sorry, folks. who, honestly, I think is one of the better developing characters on that show.
I will agree with that, yes.
But he's on there to play the Atom, and I think they just kind of, like, meshed all these people together and these characters together just to have another show.
Yeah. Yeah, I agree. I do agree.
To be completely honest with you, I don't want... I mean, the story and the premise of it makes sense and all that for me. I don't know. I could find, like, all sorts of ways of killing somebody if I had a time machine. Maybe not killing them, but just, absconding them from, eternity.
Right, right.
I could think of lots of ways to do it. I'm really enjoying the interaction, though, between some of the characters and all that. Leonard Snart, Captain Cold, just having him in the group to be, the guy who points out how stupid some of their ideas are and how pointless it is. And, if we just did this,
yeah.
we'd be fine, and we could all go home. But nope, you pansies want to do that. It always cracks me up hearing him and everything. But, it's the only show on here. It's the only show on this list of shows, all these shows we have, that I have serious doubts about. Yeah. Only because, the end game is, they've got to, stop Vandal Savage. But, seriously, at some point, you guys are going to actually have to stop Vandal Savage.
Yeah. Yeah, I would very much like to see some progress.
They've sort of introduced other antagonists, the Kronos character, which now is no longer an antagonist because we found out, hey, he's Heatwave.
Yeah.
and he's back. And he's on the same team, and then they introduced, like the very next episode, they tried to introduce these hunters who, I'm sorry, were freaking pushovers.
Yes, they were.
Those guys stand, and now we found out about this pilgrim who is going back in time to take these guys out before they even time traveled.
Yeah.
That's going to be interesting to see how that goes. But, seriously, when your entire premise of your show is based around stopping one main antagonist. Mm. Eventually, you're going to have to stop that one main antagonist, or else you're just going to look like a bunch of idiots.
I agree, 100%.
That's like Spider-Man only having Dr. Octopus as a villain to fight, or Superman only having Lex Luthor, Batman only having the Joker. Eventually, you're going to have to stop this guy and put him in jail, or do something.
Agreed. Agreed.
I mean, at least with, like Arrow and the Flash, they may have one antagonist, one main antagonist per season, but at least, another one's going to come up.
Mm-hmm.
And there's almost always a new or different one or a returning one each episode.
Right.
So.
Always something new to explore.
Yeah, with Legends of Tomorrow, though, they only get that one main antagonist, dude. And what's the end game? Stop them, right? So let's stop them. Let's stop screwing around.
I don't get it, man. It's almost as if they have two antagonists. It's him, and then it's themselves. Mm-hmm. Because if they're not trying to fight him, they're completely destroying history. Like it's so baffling to me that every single episode. Rip Hunter says, hey, don't mess with the timeline. And then somebody else goes, hey, let's mess with the timeline. Every single episode.
But, I don't know if in this most recent episode and all that, I think they may have, given some justification to them messing with the timeline. Because if you remember at the end of the episode, that little kid that Stein saved from tuberculosis turned out to be H.G. Wells.
And I didn't like that. When he first met the kid, I knew because I don't like the show I knew that they were going to end it with the kid being important, and not just important, but good important. And I said to myself, this is not a good lesson, because what if this kid was not H.G. Wells? What if this kid was freaking Stalin? No, that's not even the best example. What if this kid was someone who in our history died but would have grown up to become another Hitler, Stalin, whoever? But because he saved him, you know, history changes and we get this another dictator.
And they kind of broached that subject with the previous episode.
The little kid, right?
Yeah, when they went in the future and, you know, they kidnapped that kid who, like, you know, was, as Rip said, you know, growing up, you know, we learned about him the same way you learned about Hitler.
Right.
You know, according to, you know, Gideon and everything, you know, his disappearance from the timeline or removal from the timeline didn't have any effect on things. So even if he died, it wouldn't have an effect. But I don't know. I mean, it's like I said, I mean, I think some things are preordained and some things are not.
Mm-hmm.
Obviously, if you change one thing, no, that's something, you know, bad is going to go, you know, if you change something, you know, one from one way to another, you know, things could end up completely differently. As you know, they've even said, you know, Rip's even said in the show, you know, and the science fiction time travel theory is like, you know, a little one of my little like hobby things and all that. I remember sitting, you know, here I'm dating myself again. I remember sitting in the theater when Back to the Future 2 came out and explaining it to my friends, you know, because they were confused as shit. they're like, wait, what's going on? Rip said that, time, you know, has a way of, you know, making itself end up with the same results.
Mm-hmm.
So at certain moments. So, I mean, it could be just the fact that, you know, their time travels, what they are doing with the timeline, you know, the changes they're making are, you know, intentional. They were supposed to, you know, do this. Stein was supposed to save this kid, you know, H.G. Wells, so he could write, you know, his books and stuff. You know, there may be other instances where they do the exact same thing. I don't know.
But that also leads to, I mean, based on what you're saying, that could also be the very reason that he comes into power the way he comes into power.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? So it's like, for me, in that situation, on one hand, I'm saying, man, maybe we shouldn't do anything at all, because maybe that's why this is happening. But on the other hand, I'm saying, okay, if we're going to do something, let's just do that something. You know what I mean? Because, like you're saying, you know, maybe this happens and maybe this doesn't happen, but you don't know. Like, you don't know at all what thing makes this next thing happen. It could be your inaction or it could be your action. You know what I mean?
Mm-hmm.
So, I don't know. For me, it's almost like playing God, because you're using your morality, your code, based on the knowledge and wisdom you have at this moment in your life to make decisions that alter time. I mean, millions, billions people. You know what I mean? So that's one of the things. And because they're so cavalier about it, that's another thing that bothered me. Like, that, it's just, hey, let's have fun kind of thing. You know what I mean? And I do not like that for something so potent. You know? Ugh.
Yeah.
And then, one of the main things that turned me off about the show is they have these guys do things, some of them, that are almost completely out of character. Like, I don't remember if it's the first or second episode, and this bothered me, but when Stein knocked out Jax so that they could travel, that, I mean, what Martin Stein do you know that you have seen from his inception in this universe to now would have done that?
Well, you know what I mean? I mean, the only thing I can accredit that to is the sheer excitement over being able to travel through time.
Dude, you know, he is 50-something, at
least.
Well,
I know, but I mean, it's, you know, it's but think about it, though. I mean, he is 50-something. He is one of the top minds in his field,
mm-hmm.
if not, you know, one of the top minds, you know, in science, you know, overall. You know, what else is there left for him to learn?
Yeah, I can get that, I can understand the desire, yeah. but I mean, to turn that desire into forcing a 20-year-old boy.
Oh yeah, I know, dude. If I was Jax, I'd be so pissed off at him. I'd be like, "Are you turn this car around now?"
Exactly, man. Oh my gosh, that was the first thing that I was like, "Nope, not doing it. Sorry." You know, but it is what it is, and I will continue to watch the show, even if just to see how they muck up the timeline more, and maybe Vandal Savage extra superpowers.
See if they end the universe.
Yeah.
I want to love the show. I want to enjoy the show, especially because I like the way, like I said, you know, the most interestingly developing character on the show right now is the Adam Ray Palmer.
Right. Yeah.
To me, at least.
I agree with
you. So I want to see, you know, how this show goes and, you know, where his character goes and everything. But yeah, I mean, they need to either really, you know, demonstrate the consequences of, you know, changing the timeline, you know, especially if there are drastic changes,
mm-hmm.
which, I mean, they kind of have touched on, you know, with, you know, a couple episodes where, you know, Ray left a piece of his armor got, you know, broken off in a fight, and, you know, they were able to reverse engineer it, and Savage was able to, you know, take over the world sooner and shit,
right.
But, you know, they've kind of touched on stuff like that, but, you know, as far as, you know, like, you know, they save, you know, this kid, you know, playing in the street from getting run over by a car, you know, and he grows up to be, you know, Hitler or, you know, Stalin, like you said, you know, do they go back and do they stop that? Mm-hmm. I mean, honestly, for all the people that, you know, talk about, you know, if, you know, you could time, if you go back in time, would you kill Hitler? Hitler was not the only one.
Mm-hmm.
You would have to kill a lot of freaking people. Not just Hitler, right, to stop the Holocaust and all those atrocities. But, what's his name? Himmler? Himmler is probably worse than Hitler was.
Mm.
But that's another thing. So this takes us into our last show here that we have not yet talked about here. We're talking about Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yep.
So you mentioned it earlier, saying you had big hopes for its first season.
Yes, I did. You know, Clark Gregg was one of my favorite characters since, you know, he came up in Iron Man. Mm-hmm. You know, so when I found out they were bringing him back and doing this whole, you know, S.H.I.E.L.D. undercover kind of thing, the Avengers weren't going to know that he was alive and that deal, I was psyched. You know, I really wanted to see what was going to happen. And whereas the storyline was decent, I think the plots for the episodes were not, and I think some of the acting was pretty bad, too. But this was just, I can't even tell you if it was the entire first season or just some of it. But I can say for sure that from the start of the second season, it started to get better. And then when, Winter Soldier, when they started to do the tie-in, with that, it just became a completely different show. It was almost as if a light switch came on in that writing room or something, and it has become one of my favorite shows to watch now.
Yeah. Getting into it was, kind of slow and hard because, you know, I mean, they were introducing, you know, these characters and everything, and you're kind of like, you know, why do they need to bring a hacker on board? Doesn't SHIELD train people right. to use computers? But then, you know, they introduced the whole backstory with her and all that, and things started to, you know, make a little bit more sense, you know, why she was brought along and everything. And then, you know, everything just went from, you know, hey, it's not Sky, it's Daisy, a.k.a. Right. Quake.
Right.
You know,
right.
And you're like, oh, okay, now everything's full circle. So everything's making a lot more sense. And, yeah, I'm really enjoying the show. I mean, I had my like, oh man, you know, don't touch Lola,
right?
You know, moments, you know, with it and everything like that. But I've loved the fact that they have incorporated moments, you know, like you mentioned with Winter Soldier, mm-hmm. And they did it again most recently with Age of Ultron,
right?
Where you know the Omega, you know, what was it, the Omega Protocol or something like that at the end there. I mean, I screwed up because the last episode, the episode before the Age of Ultron premiere, I didn't watch it.
Oh.
So when I, you know, watched Age of Ultron, and then I came home and like the next day I watched the episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., where it's like, okay, yeah, Stryker's right here. And I'm like, that's how they found him. I was like, that's how they found him, you know. And then you got Maria Hill up there, and she's like, you know, Omega, you know, protocol activate. You know, he's like, yeah, definitely. Mm. You know, and, you know, when you're watching Age of Ultron, you know, you see, that's when Fury shows up with the freaking helicarrier and stuff. I was like, oh my God, right, why did I was never watching one of these movies before an episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D.
Yeah, absolutely, yeah.
So I'm definitely going to be keeping up on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. before Civil War comes out.
Oh, God, yes.
Because it's getting there, I think. But, you know, the way Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. has been going, a lot different than I think what they're going to be dealing with in Civil War, in regards to this Hive character.
This is true.
Which I don't know that much about, but it's very interesting.
Yeah, I like what they're doing with Ward. I mean, he seems to be this jack of all trades dude, because obviously you remember from in the first season. I mean, completely different character. This guy has
played, I know,
what, three different versions of himself, and it has been phenomenal, you know? So I do like what they're doing with the Hive thing and the Inhumans, even though there's still this disconnect as far as what the cinematic universe is going to do with the Inhumans with their movie, which was recently pushed back again to who knows. It was supposed to be 2019, I think, and now they don't even know if it's going to be then.
Well, I think, though, we've seen a hint, a little Easter egg, though, about what, the Inhumans and the Kree technology and everything like that may be pointing in the direction of a movie that is coming out.
Yes.
Not very soon, but soon.
Mm-hmm.
And all that, where in the last episode with Paradise Lost, just aired this week, we had a moment there where Daisy and Lincoln, they go to visit this one guy who wanted to become, who has the potential to become Inhuman, who wanted to be given powers and all that, but it was kicked out of the community or whatever, so he was not getting any powers, where he had some artifacts, some Inhuman artifacts, that, you know, he'd stolen, and he pulled one out which Daisy recognized as being Kree. But if you pause that moment there, that's, you know, and take a closer look at that sphere, you can see what something that almost, but very closely looks like the same symbol or architecture or design of Doctor Strange's Sanctum Sanctorum window.
Yes, yes. I did not notice it when I first watched it, but when you mentioned that to me, I took a look and I said, wow, I mean, the similarities were striking. The one caveat that you just touched on, that it's very similar, slight difference, is there's an extra line at the bottom there. So there is a possibility that it doesn't mean anything. I did a search online. I couldn't find any connection between Doctor Strange's universe, his happenings, or rather, I should say, and Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. But obviously, they don't do comics one-to-one, and it could very well be something that shows up in the future, or not. But it does look... Oh, my goodness. It's incredibly similar. And when you told me that, I got so excited. You probably couldn't tell, but I was... Because Doctor Strange is one of my favorite characters. And I was like, wow, if this is happening, I'm just going to explode all over myself. I'll probably edit that out. But anyway, yes, I was super excited. Fantastic stuff.
Yeah, so, maybe we'll find out. Because, you know, Doctor Strange, yes, he travels to Tibet, and this is where he learns all of his sorcerously powers and everything, becomes the Sorcerer Supreme.
Mm-hmm.
Safe place, the community that the Inhumans had was not far from there. It was not far from Tibet.
That is very true.
So, you know, there may be some correlation in history there, you know, because this guy talks about one of the founding Inhumans. You know, they had Inhumans and the humans had to band together to, you know, beat this guy.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe there was some mystical, you know,
connection
in there with all that.
I would not be mad at that at all. That sounds pretty fantastic, to be honest with you. Wow.
You know, that sounds pretty cool. I don't think I'll get pissed off at it.
Yeah. Precisely. That is very good. That's two you've got today, sir. Two you've got with me. The Laurel thing, as far as faking her death, and this. That's yeah. It's, yeah.
Oh, I can spin theories all day, sir. I can spin theories all day. But you know whether I'm right or not.
Right.
You never know.
We'll
never
see.
Know. I mean, I was the one who predicted that. Jesse Eisenberg's Lex Luthor was just portraying himself as an eccentric millionaire.
And then you turned out to be wrong. And again, if you guys have listened to the review and the podcast, I actually like that. That's a difference of opinion we'll have here. And I think I had the same difference of opinion with James. He didn't like it either. You know, but we'll see. We did get the shaved head at the end there. And his time in prison might... quiet down those nerves a little bit. We'll see.
See, my thing is this, all right? Somebody tried to explain to me that Jesse Eisenberg's... he wasn't so much channeling the Joker or the Riddler with his portrayal of Lex Luthor, but he was more channeling Renfield from the Dracula novel. Renfield's the guy who, you know, like, eats the bugs,
mm-hmm.
you know, for Dracula, you know, and, you know, serves Dracula and everything like that. He became an obsessive, twitchy psycho,
right.
You know, rambling on about the arrival of the Master, which, you know, is obviously going to be Darkseid and everything. Here's my thing, though, okay? Lex Luthor is no Renfield. Lex right. Luthor is no pawn for some alien demon or god. He is Lex Luthor.
I agree.
You know?
I wouldn't say that he was channeling anyone, honestly. I think what he was doing was he was playing out the eccentric billionaire that had this past that he was still a child. Like that whole girl interrupted kind of situation. Mm-hmm. You know, he never developed into what he could have been because of the relationship he had with his father, and then there was no one after that to help him become who he's supposed to be. So his whole, just like Batman, his whole life philosophy was developed the moment nobody with power was able to help him. You know what I mean? And I think that what he's doing is providing this foundation, and then his experiences from Batman v Superman until whenever will mold him into a Lex Luthor that people will remember better, I guess, from the comics or from the animated series and things like that.
Yeah.
Or at least I should say that's my hope, you know. Because I do prefer the calm and the cool and the collected Lex. You know, I think Bryan Cranston would have made a phenomenal
Lex. Oh, my God. You're damn right.
did you hear about that interview with Snyder where he said he was actually talking to Cranston for Lex, but when he interviewed Jesse Eisenberg for a completely different role, the way Eisenberg was in the interview changed Snyder's mind. And Snyder was talking to his wife, I think, and he was like, man, we should just have this guy do Lex Luthor and have him portrayed this way. And when I read that, I didn't know how to feel, because while I liked that, I so much would have preferred Cranston. I said, this was the reason he wasn't in there? Are you kidding me? Oh my gosh, man. That would have been beautiful. Beautiful.
Yeah.
But yeah, so all right, so we have covered Legends and Gotham and Arrow, Supergirl, Flash. Obviously the Netflix series, there's not much to cover because they've been out for so long already. But I guess news in the future, we get Luke Cage in September, Iron Fist sometime after that. We got casting for Iron Fist. Danny Rand is the main character. He'll be played by Finn Jones from Game of Thrones. You guys remember him. It's pretty exciting. A lot of controversy, but pretty exciting.
Yeah.
You know, a lot of people there, apparently they don't like the fact that the main character is not Asian. Even though
Danny Rand was not Asian. Danny Rand was a blonde white boy.
Thank you. Right?
Sorry, folks.
Now, there are people who say, oh, they could have used this opportunity to cast an Asian.
They could have used this opportunity to make Black Panther a white man, too.
Right. You know what I'm saying?
Or a Native American, but they didn't.
You know, I, the whole point of the story was, I mean, this guy, he was a fish out of water. When he was a kid and being trained, you know, and you lose that if you make him Asian, you know. Yeah. And some Asians have come out and said they don't want him to be Asian because you're typecasting the character because he's a martial arts character now, you know. So there's both sides of this thing, and I'm fine. I mean, the guy's name is Danny Rand. He's a white guy, and he was trained for a lot of his life in an Asian culture, and I think that's phenomenal source material to come from. That's rich for storytelling, so I don't see why they would want to change it in the first place.
Yeah.
You know. But anyway, we have gone on for quite long, yep. So I guess we are going to end this thing. Man, it has been almost 2 hours, so we'll see what that gets edited down to. I want to thank you guys
I only got an hour and a half. We're good.
Oh, yeah. Thank you guys for tuning in. And thank you, Super Patriot from the Daddy's House. Go check him out.
Yeah.
So we'll see you guys next time inside the review.
Bye.